The new Cupertino Library was constructed 9 years ago. In a previous program dated November 1996, the better part showed you all the features throughout the new library. But as you know, nothing stays static. Stay tuned and hear and see all about all the changes that have taken place during those intervening years and our guest views for the future. Sharing starts here.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
Our guest today has been running the Cupertino Library for 3 years. He has previous experience with the Contra Costa County Library System and the library director of the Athenian School in Danville, California. Mark has also taught library courses at several community colleges in the Bay Area. Please welcome Mark Fink.
Thank you for having me on today.
Mark, let's begin with the services of the library, such as joining, library card, borrowing books, and using computers and technology.
The video that you just saw, that video has footage from several of the libraries that are part of the Santa Clara County Library District. The Cupertino Library is one of the libraries that's part of that district. So as far as joining the library, we are the Santa Clara County Library District, which includes the following cities. It includes Cupertino, Campbell, Gilroy, Morgan Hill, Monte Sereno, Los Altos, Los Altos Hills, and Saratoga, along with the unincorporated areas that are part of Santa Clara County. So altogether, we serve about 410,000 residents.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah, and so for all of those residents, they're all entitled to free library cards. If people live outside of the district, but they're still interested in joining our library system, they're able to do so, but the library card, there's a fee associated with that card, and it runs $80. Although, based on the resources that we have at our libraries, we feel that the cost is very worthwhile. Mm-hmm. Another thing that we offer for free are student cards for all the school districts and all the students that attend those schools that overlap with the library district's boundaries. Mm-hmm. As far as some of the different kinds of resources that the library offers, a lot of people just think that the library has a lot of books. We actually have quite a few other types of items that people can borrow. We've got the books, we've got DVDs, we have Blu-ray discs, we also have music files, and we have magazines. A lot of different formats. So we have a very wide selection of different kinds of resources that people can actually go to the library to borrow. We also have really extensive collections that are geared specifically for families, for children, for teens, and for adults. So in general, we have a very generous policy as far as the number of items that people can borrow on a library card. So a general library card, you can borrow up to about 100 items at one time.
I was very impressed. When I went there on the interview, or went there to a tour, it was very impressive on how well they did and how you checked all the books at one time, mm-hmm. Doing the automatic checkers, which I thought were fantastic.
Yeah. Another thing, too, just about the Cupertino Library in general, since we have so many items that people can borrow, we actually have a very high, we have very solid statistics. Mm-hmm. We actually, people check out almost 3 million items a year from the Cupertino Library, and to give you some context for that, the main library in San Francisco, mm-hmm. Which is much larger and serves a larger population, we actually have a higher rate of circulation in Cupertino than the main library in San Francisco.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Mark, the area for return books, I was very impressed with that, by the way, has greatly improved. Mm-hmm. Would you explain the changes and how they affected the library?
The main change, especially since 1996, has been that we have a lot more, we use a lot more technology to kind of make the process faster for people that want to borrow materials from the library. So the first thing that we've done is we've taken all the barcodes that are on all of the books, and we've actually replaced the barcodes with what we call RFID tags. An RFID tag is a radio frequency identification tag, and it makes the process more efficient for people to borrow materials. Instead of just having to manually check out one book at a time, and if you had 100 books, that would take you a long time.
Yes.
So with the RFID tags, you can stack several books at one time, and the sensors read all of those tags at once, so it really speeds up the checkout process. Another thing that we've done is we've added several self-service stations in the library, in the lobby, mm-hmm. so that people can actually scan their library card and check out items on their own. And then they receive a receipt, and it's a much faster process. If we have people that do want personalized assistance, we still also have clerks that work at a accounts desk in the lobby, so they've got a couple different options. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the new process that we're using for people to check out books. One of the things that really expedites the process for getting our items back on the shelves is we have essentially an automated conveyor belt system that reads those RFID tags and assists with the sorting. So we have about 10,000 items that get returned almost every day. And those items, if we just had barcodes and we had to have people manually sort all of those items, it would be very labor intensive, and it would take us a long time to get everything back on the shelves.
I remember in the old days they used to have that.
Yeah. Yeah. So now we can actually, once an item is returned at the library, we can actually get it back on the shelves and make it available for other patrons, usually within 24 hours.
Speaking of the computers and technology, I know you have a lot to say about the databases. Mm-hmm. I know we could probably make a whole program on itself, but could you kind of explain some of it?
Generally, one of the first questions that people have is, you know, well what is a database? So one of the things that I like to let people know is kind of how a library database is a little bit different than if you just go on the internet and do a Google search. So for example, if you are interested in learning something on a new particular subject, let's say that you are really interested in learning how to plant a container garden. Well, if you typed in container garden on Google, you'd probably get a million different results that show up. And you know, the first things that are going to show up in your on the search page are sponsored links or advertisements. Mm-hmm. So with the library databases, one of the things one of the reasons why the library provides those databases for free to people with library cards is there's no advertising, so there's no commercials or anything like that, and the information is ranked when you do a search. Either by a keyword search or by title. You can also have it ranked by the most recently published information. Mm-hmm. So a database actually provides you with kind of a way to organize information that's been published in other sources. Mm-hmm. It could be through newspapers, could be through popular media, you know, Time Magazine, People Magazine, or something like that. Or it could be a peer-reviewed journal, mm-hmm. Such as the New England Journal of Medicine. Mm-hmm. So we provide you with several different layers of information, and you kind of have your choice about the types of information that work best for what you're researching. Mm-hmm. And again, all of this is provided without being sorted based on a commercial purpose. Mm-hmm. So the database gives you access to all of that information, and essentially maybe 30 years ago when you went to the library and you just had to search through shelves and shelves of magazines or periodicals or look through microfilm, mm-hmm. The databases that the library provides, all of that information is now accessible to you on either your computer or your smartphone.
Oh, that's a really improvement.
Yeah. And some of the databases that we offer, we have a very wide range of topics that are covered with the databases. We've got, first of all, one of the primary reasons why we have the databases are to support students and their coursework. Mm-hmm. And we have specific databases for elementary school students, also for middle school students and high school students. Mm-hmm. And we also, for the general public, we have an auto repair database. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of just general news and current events kinds of sources. Mm-hmm. And we also have more specialized resources such as investment databases. So that would be something like Morningstar that you could access on with your library mm-hmm. card for free, that if you purchased it on your own would be very expensive.
Mm-hmm. Do you interface with the different other libraries like San Francisco Library and so on?
The Santa Clara County Library District is part of a consortium, and what that means is they work with some other library systems around California, which helps them get the best pricing on some of these databases. Okay. Many of the databases that the Santa Clara County Library District offers are also offered by other library systems throughout California. Mm-hmm. One of the things that the Cupertino Library and the Santa Clara County Library District in general really take pride on is the variety and the depth of the resources that mm-hmm. we have for patrons. And I think that there's a real emphasis on that because, you know, we do live in Silicon Valley, and there's an expectation right. that you don't have any limits to the information that you want to access. Mm-hmm. So you're not restricted to just when the library is open to the public, but you can access these things 24/7.
That sounds great. One thing I know you're very interested in is what the Plane Tree Information Center is now located in the Cupertino Library building. Mm-hmm. How did that come about?
Plane Tree has been in the South Bay for around 24 years. You'll notice the sign behind me that mm-hmm. advertises the Plane Tree Health Information Center, which is now part of the Cupertino Library. Plane Tree has been, its mission really has been to provide in-depth and personalized medical and health information for people that have those needs. Before Plane Tree moved to the Cupertino Library, it was actually located in a hospital. and in Los Gatos. Mm-hmm. So there's it has a very specialized kind of need for people that need that kind of information. The Cupertino Library became involved with Plane Tree a few years ago when the library district did some market research and learned that there was a really high demand for kind of personal, credible health and medical kind of information. And one of the places that the public felt most comfortable finding that information was through their local library, because they really trusted the library as a resource and as a source that would provide kind of unbiased information. So seeing that need, that our patrons had, and also looking at working with Plane Tree, we were able to kind of work on an agreement where we were able to help Plane Tree find a new space, which was on the second floor of the Cupertino Library. And now we have a partnership with Plane Tree. And so Plane Tree is open 20 hours a week. You don't need a library card to access the services. Anybody who walks in the doors will get the services. Really what it does, Plane Tree offers you kind of a really in-depth opportunity to get information to any of your medical or health related questions. And it can be, questions about a very complex medical procedure, or it might just be questions about, improving nutrition, or what foods you might want to change in your diet to help make you feel better. But Plane Tree has highly trained volunteers that actually sit down with you for, 15 minutes or so to really kind of walk you through and give you the information that you need. So we're happy that we're able to offer that service now at the Cupertino Library. And part of this was made possible by a grant from the Cupertino Library Foundation, so that Plane Tree was able to move into its new space at the library.
That sounds very nice. I gather a lot of people use it.
We are really working to try and make sure that everybody in the community is aware of Plane Tree as a resource. Part of being on this program today is really about making sure people understand the valuable resource that we have available in Plane Tree, and there's no library card required. And if you have a question, a health question or a medical question, we encourage you to stop by.
Mark, what are the library resources?
In addition to a lot of the materials that we have in the building, a lot of people have just have this idea that a library is just nothing but books on a shelf. But one of the things that makes the Cupertino Library and the Library District in general such a valued resource is that we actually do so much more than just provide a place for people to come and borrow some books. So I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the things that we offer at the Cupertino Library in addition to our collection. I should say that our collection is actually quite good. We have about 400,000 items just in the building in Cupertino.
Yes.
And then we also provide patrons with access to almost 2 million items through our other partner libraries. And you can actually go online with your library card and reserve items and have them sent to Cupertino from some of our other locations so that you can pick them up. But we also do quite a bit of outreach into the community, and we also offer a lot of programs at the library, and I think that's one reason why the Cupertino Library is seen as being so vibrant and successful. We offer about 60 programs a month, and we actually average about 35,000 people a year that attend the programs that we offer at the library. And the programs, they're all free. You don't need a library card. And we have a wide variety of programs for families. We've got great story times, for children from, being babies all the way up to being toddlers, up to even older. And we offer several story times every week. We also have programs specifically for teens. In fact, one of the great programs that we're offering for teens right now is the library has a teen advisory board that includes high school students from some of the local high schools. And they've decided that they wanted to take on more specific volunteer type projects that involve the library. So one of the things that they've done is they've created a community garden at the library. So the library has a courtyard, and they've got some raised beds in the courtyard, and they're growing vegetables. And they're actually just they're learning One about, you know, what works best for this particular climate. They're working with the Master Gardeners organization and volunteers from that organization. And they're also, you know, once they harvest what they're growing, they're gonna donate the food to a local food bank.
Mark, the international language section has really grown. Would you tell us what that section entails?
As you know, Cupertino is very diverse, and we've really made an effort to try and offer more of our materials in languages other than English. So in Cupertino, we actually have a very popular Chinese collection. And the materials that we have in our international language collection, they include fiction, you know, popular fiction, and some nonfiction. We also have some DVDs. We also have some CDs. And we also offer some periodicals. Mm-hmm. We also have a database that actually provides access to publications that are in Chinese, mm-hmm. That people can access again with their library card through the library's website. I think that what we're finding is that, you know, there's just a really high demand for the library offering resources in languages other than English, and we're really working on trying to meet that demand. Mm-hmm. And we have countless numbers of languages that we offer some materials in. And again, one of the great features is that if you don't find something at the Cupertino Library that you're looking for that might be in another language, we have our other libraries where we can search those libraries and send you the items, send them to Cupertino so that you can pick them up on hold.
When I was there, I saw it, and it was quite large.
Yeah, and actually, just a couple weeks ago, we had a really great author event with an author who, you know, it was in the event was conducted in Mandarin, and mm-hmm. we had it at Quinlan, and we actually had a capacity crowd for that particular event. And then we also have a book club that meets every other month, and that's conducted in Mandarin as well. Mm-hmm. So in addition, you know, we're trying to branch out not just with our collection, but some of the programs that we offer by offering them in other languages right. as well.
What about the California Western Americana?
That collection is actually, it's something that has been at Cupertino for many, many years, and we like to think of it as kind of our rare book or our historical collection. And that collection, we call it the CWA collection because the materials in it are from California, mm-hmm. The West, and from America in general. There's a nice section that really ties in with local history, and then also with some of the broader history of California. So one of the things that we do to promote that collection, we actually have a partnership with several other local organizations, including the Cupertino Library Foundation, mm-hmm. the Cupertino Historical Society, and the California History Center at De Anza. And at De Anza College. And that, this group of organizations, we call this project the Santa Clara Valley History Collaborative. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we try and do are offer resources that highlight aspects of this CWA collection, but also provide some programs that go with it. So mm-hmm. probably the most successful program that we've done that's been part of this collaborative has been we called it Moving Days, and it was really focused on, we partnered with the Japanese American Museum of San Jose, and were able to have some of their items on loan and display them at the Cupertino Library. And the focus of the exhibit was really about the Japanese American experience from 1900 to the present.
Are some of the books in those two sections that we just talked about reference book only?
We have kind of three levels for that collection. We've got some items that are cataloged as reference, but we also have copies that people can borrow from the library. Some of the more rare items that we have that are part of that collection, those are items that you can use in the library. And to actually access that service, you would just check in at the reference desk on the second mm-hmm. floor, and a librarian would help you get access to those resources. Mm-hmm. And then you could use them in the library, but you wouldn't be able to take them home with you.
How about the teen room? I was kind of fascinated by that when we visited. It looked pretty...
I can say that, you know, since 1996, a lot has changed with how the library approaches teen services. And part of those changes are really evident in the teen room that we have mm-hmm. at the Cupertino Library. So There are a lot of community organizations that came together, including Cupertino Rotary and the Friends of the Cupertino Library and the City of Cupertino and the Cupertino Library Foundation. And essentially, they came together and they provided about $180,000 to renovate the teen room. But it wasn't just this process of gathering the money to fund the renovation, but we actually had teens that were involved from the very beginning of the process. So local teens were surveyed, you know, kind of to find out what they would want in their own space, what kind of resources that they would want, you know, what kinds of changes that they would want to see from the existing space. So all of those survey results and all of that, the focus groups involving the teens were used to kind of plan the process of the new room. And then the teens were also involved with designing or choosing the colors and the kind of designs of the furniture. So really, the idea is that it provides a completely comfortable space for teens, and it's welcoming in part because they were actually involved in the design. Mm-hmm. So the teen room, it has its own collection. So it has a nonfiction collection and a teen fiction collection, which has grown quite a bit over the years. And it also has its own computers located in that space, really comfortable furniture. Mm-hmm. And we also have a large graphic novel collection. Graphic novels, it's a more modern term for comic books. And we also, part of that collection is anime, which is also very popular. Mm-hmm. So the library provides not just really great supplemental educational resources for teens, but we also provide them with resources that appeal more to their side, their less academic side, their reading for entertainment kind of side.
Well, Mark, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to keep up with the latest news about the library. Uh-huh. And thank you for coming.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed having this opportunity to share a little bit more information about the library.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm Chuck Sigelski of The Better Part. Tune in again next week. Copies of our shows are also available in the Santa Clara County Library System, including Cupertino, and also some on YouTube. Let us know if you have people or topics you would like to see on our show. We can be reached at the Cupertino Senior Center, 408-777-3150, or on www.thebetterpart.com.